So I want to thank everyone for gathering here on the grounds of Honolulu Hale on a beautiful Monday in Hawaii. And, you know, judging from what we see out here, it looks like it's a perfect world out there. But we do not live in a perfect world right now. We're still in the midst of a pandemic. And in fact, in the last almost 4 weeks now of June, we've seen more cases on the island Oahu than we've seen for months. And it's returning to nearer levels of what we saw at the height of this in March and April. And it tells everyone here on this island that we're not through this yet, and that we cannot let our guard down, that we need to practice all the proper protocols, starting with wearing face coverings, which I had on until I started the talk, and practicing good physical distancing of 6 feet. And if we don't do these things, we're going to continue to see cases rise as we open up. And the island of Oahu, now we've opened up everything pretty much to one degree or another, except for large events, sporting events, and entertainment events. And I think we're starting to see the result of that, although I also think it's a result of some of us letting our guard down. And so as mayor, I'm really requesting, please, please, please practice all the proper protocols, or we're going to be facing difficult decisions like the mayor of Houston recently, where he's stepping back, shutting down bars, the mayor of San Francisco slowing down the reopening. We don't want to do these things. We need to continue this progress to thaw out our economy, to get people back to work. Otherwise, we're going to be in a lot more trouble this coming fall than we are today. And we saw the product of that this past weekend when we had our first COVID-19 positive case for a bus driver. And as mayor, it's very disconcerting to me, as it is for the entire team at OTS. And when I say entire team, it includes the union leader, who has stepped up and come to us and said, we need to work together to protect his, union members, who are our bus drivers and our handy van drivers. For me, it's one of the most difficult jobs you can do on the island of Oahu, with extreme patience, because of the kind of traffic you're usually driving in and the kind of people you encounter, not all of them carrying aloha in their heart as they board the bus. So with that, I want to talk a little bit more about what we're going to be doing in light of this most recent case with one of our bus drivers testing positive, which was not surprising. With that, I'm going to turn over to Roger Morton, who runs our bus operation, and he does it very, very well. Roger.
Thank you, Mayor. Aloha, everybody. Yes, on Sunday night, when I was just about to go to bed, and I started getting messages that one of our operators had tested positive. First, you know, it was a shock to us, not unexpected, as the mayor said, and we were thankful that we've had only one so far. Many cities have had a lot more people get infected in the transit business. So the mayor asked me to talk a little bit about what we were going to do in response to our positive test. Well, first, as it was not unexpected, for some weeks now, we have been internally debating what's our next steps. I think we've gone through all the things that we're doing already in terms of trying to keep our buses safe, the cleaning, the protocols, and all the other things. But now I think it's time for us to move on to what's the next steps that we can take to try to ensure the public that we're going to run the safest system possible. And so as a result of that, we've made the following decisions: that starting on Thursday, this Thursday coming up, we're going to implement a 100% thermal screening protocol when our operators and our handy van workers check in for work. We're going to do 100% everyday screening for fever and temperature. We had already fortuitously on last Friday, our shipment of handheld thermometers to get that done arrived at our offices. We didn't think we were going to put them in service quite as quickly as we are, but we're going to start doing that in 2 days on Thursday. Then on Friday, we are going to, with the Premier Medical Group, Friday is recognized as Independence Day, so our operation is a little bit smaller than that, but we're going to pilot our first testing protocol to test our frontline workers as they come to work. Now, testing is a point in time, and so I test today. I might get a virus tomorrow. So it's not an end all, but we're gonna do 100% of our employees over the next week or so, and then our protocol is going to be to assess where we're at. If we look like we have that we're good, we don't have any infections, then we will probably do that every month. And if we start having any infections, then we'll reassess. We may do it every 2 weeks. If we have a problem, we may do it every week. It really doesn't make sense to us that we would do it every day, but that's what our plan is right now, starting on Friday. And I think on that score, we have already been talking to our union about partnering with us in this, or encouraging our employees to participate in this. And I'm happy to say that, you know, we all have the same concern for our employees. We want to make sure that they're safe, that they have a safe workplace that they're working in, and we also want to make sure that our buses are safe for the riding public. But at this time, I'd like to call up the president of the Teamsters Union, Mr. Wayne Lula. You better spell it, Wayne. I always get it right.
Yeah. Sorry, buddy.
No problem. Hi, my name is Wayne Ka'ululau, and I'm the president of the Teamsters Union. First of all, I'd like to say we are in strong support of what the management at OTS is proposing to do in regards to testing for our members. We still need to meet with our stewards to bring them up to date as to what the plans are moving forward. But once again, we are in strong support of what the company is planning on doing. I also wanted to mention that the union office is closed today and tomorrow, basically because one of our business agents actually met with this individual who we later found out had COVID-19, tested positive for COVID-19. So following CDC guidelines, we closed our office today and tomorrow. Our office staff had to go and do COVID testing to see whether they're positive or not. And then they're also disinfecting our office. So once all of that is done, then the office will reopen on Wednesday. And that's pretty much all I have for now. Thank you.
And I want to thank again Wayne Ka'ululau for what he's done for his membership, making sure they're protected, and working with us and Roger in particular to make sure that all of his bus drivers, both those who drive bus and handy van, are one, temperature checked and tested as needed so that they're protected and safe. And they know that when they go home with their loved ones, that the city and the OTS has done what's necessary to protect them. As you know, we're a city also that believes in testing, robust testing, aggressive testing. We've had our challenges there, but testing, contact tracing, aggressive, tested, ready contact tracers and isolation with support are critical as we open up. And if we don't have that in place, we are going to be in deep kimchi. To that extent, Hiro Toya, who is the head of our Department of Emergency Management, has been tasked with the challenges of making sure we're doing as much testing as possible. And he's worked hard and worked on agreements that are now in place with our 7 community health centers. And he's going to be sharing with you what we're going to be doing, working with our community health centers to address concerns about those who rode on the bus that were driven by this driver during these periods over the 5 days that he was driving while sick. Hiro.
Thank you, Mayor Caldwell. My name is Hiro Toya. I'm the director of the Department of Emergency Management for the City and County of Honolulu. So this incident serves as a reminder that as we open up, we have to learn to live with COVID, and we have to learn how to protect each other. And I want to just make sure the risk to the public is clearly characterized here. The bus already had a number of safety protocols in place. In fact, all the drivers are required to wear masks, and all the riders are also required to wear the masks. And the amount of contact that each passenger has with a driver is a very limited amount of time. So we do not believe this is a high-risk event for the public. But that being said, we want to make sure that everybody who needs to get tested has access to testing. So the following community health centers are able to provide testing for Anybody who rode the bus who feel like they need to get tested, also including the drivers, Kalihi Palama Health Center, Kokua Kalihi Valley Comprehensive Family Services, and they're focused on the 96819 zip code, Ko'olauloa Health Center, Waianae Coast Comprehensive Health Center, and Waimanalo Health Center. So again, both bus riders and bus drivers are able to access healthcare and COVID testing through these health centers. Now, people are encouraged to see their own doctors if they have one, just to have the continuity of care with their own physicians. But if you don't have a doctor or if you're not sure where to go, these community health centers can not only help you with COVID testing, but any number of health services that you may need. They can also help you access other health insurance services such as MedQuest. So these community health centers stand ready to see those patients. Now, when you go to these community health centers, and if you don't have health insurance, then the city has contracts in place with all the community health centers as well as the laboratories. So the city will pay for your testing. If you'd like more information on these community health centers, you can visit the Hawaii Primary Care Association website, and that's at www.hawaiipca.net. Thank you.
So in closing, a couple things. One, we have a three-part program that was announced today through Roger Morton's shop in the OTS. They're going to be doing daily temperature checks, number one. Number two, they're going to be testing every single driver of the bus and the handy van, along with their other employees. There's about a little over 2,000 total employees, about 1,300 bus drivers or handy van drivers are going to be doing that. And then for bus drivers and also bus riders who are concerned that they may have been exposed to the virus, they can go to one of the five community health centers and get tested after first checking with their primary care physician. If they don't have one, go to the community health center. And if you don't have insurance, the city will pay for the test. Now in closing, I got a simple request. If you're sick, stay at home. Please, if you're sick, stay at home. It goes for every city employee, the 10,000 of us. It goes for every employee in the private sector. This virus is still among us. And I know in Hawaii, it's our culture to work hard, right? We are kind of gambate, plantation mentality. Everyone works hard. Don't slack off. Get to work. Even if you feel sick, go to work. The old plantation days, that's what happened. But in this case, please don't be stubborn and say, I'm sick, but I don't got the virus. I'm going to go to work. And then after 5 days, say, maybe I feel really pretty darn sick. Let's get tested. Because it just takes one person to be infected and then spread it to others, particularly in a close confined situation, as we've seen in a situation of a funeral, as we've seen in situations of churches or on the continent, nightclubs or bars. And sometimes your symptoms may be moderate or not even felt at all. You don't even know, you're asymptomatic, but you're shedding the virus and spreading it. And the saddest outcome is the one where someone dies. And again, we had another death on Friday. And our condolences go out to that family who lost a loved one. And as mayor and as people, as a mayor and our team, we don't want to see any more people die. So if you're sick, stay at home, check it out, wait till you get better and come back to work. And for everybody else who's healthy every single day of the week, wear your face coverings when you're all over. And practice good physical distancing. With that, we'll open up any questions. Roger will be more than happy to answer your questions, yeah? So Roger, come on up.
Can you give us any more detail? We know the routes the driver drove. We don't know the times the driver drove. And you've got your AM, you've got your PM, your morning, your afternoon, your evening, for all of these routes.
Manolo, I think we did release that information. We did release the information on the times that the drivers were operating the routes earlier today, I believe. Michelle, can I introduce Michelle Kennedy first from my staff? And also Jenny Lemaota, my deputy over here. Both of them have been working really hard to this whole couple of days now. to do it. But we released that information. I think we made it available to the media. Maybe you haven't seen it yet.
But can you get it to Manolo? Just make sure.
Michelle is going to give it to him right now.
Wait, what am I saying? You call me.
I know we're looking like, I look like Manolo.
No, I know. I always ask you the question, what do you call one Portuguese man sleeping in a car?
Sorry.
Apologize.
So you don't know what the details are that Mineral Rogers is?
No, we do know, and we'll get that information to you.
Okay, the other thing is, I spoke with riders today, and some, you know, say, okay, the bus is doing the best job that it can.
Right.
But others are saying it's totally irresponsible for that driver to have been behind the wheel for 5 days, because if we understand it correctly, he started feeling sick on Monday,
right.
He got tested on Friday. That's a lot of people who came on and off his buses between then and then.
And I guess my answer to that is I agree with you. From our perspective right now, that was against our protocol to do that. Am I going to go after the particular driver? Probably not, no. But I do want to use it as a learning moment for all of us at the bus company and for all of our employees. It's one of the reasons that we want to start this thermal screening as well, is we need to do that, and we need to reiterate to all of our employees. Now, my understanding is that this started similar to an allergy type reaction, and that doesn't excuse it at all. But we are going to use it as a tremendous learning for all of us that it can happen to anybody, and so our employees have to follow the proper protocol.
I also have a question for you, Roger. So
sure.
What can happen to the bus driver? Could he be fired or disciplined in any way for not reporting earlier?
Well, As I say, in this case, I'm treating this as a learning moment for us. I'm not going to go after this operator, but I'm going to make it clear that I'm going to reiterate what our policy is. And going forward, there's no guarantee that we wouldn't do that. We expect our drivers to follow the protocol. Having said that, sometimes there is a subjectivity and a gray area in, am I sick? Do I have my normal allergy? So it is sometimes a hard call for people to make. But we want people to follow the protocol, that if they feel something different from what they normally feel, if they feel sick, they got to stay home.
Thank you. And what other?
We've had two known cases. One was from out of state, never drove. One and this case. As in addition to that, we have made our leave policies such that people can stay home without being subject to any type of disciplinary process or adherence to an attendance policy, and they're able to use their sick benefits and their vacation benefits. So that even if they have a vulnerable parent or someone with a health condition, we allow them to stay home. We encourage it. We allow them to use their accrued paid benefits, and we don't hold it against them. We want them to stay home in those days. In terms of numbers, I think that we had about 50 people in that category when the COVID first started. Over the last couple of months, that had dropped down to about 23. And I think we had a few more that went out today, actually, because of the current incident. But not a lot of people. And we have made it clear that it's better for them to err on the side of public safety. Stay home if they have any concerns whatsoever.
Roger, are you concerned with any route more than another? Because I know the number 9
yeah.
is the Chinatown route. That's a lot of senior citizens going to Chinatown to shop.
I'm glad you asked the question, because yes, we are concerned about some routes more than others. We've implemented a different scheduling system. We call it dynamic headway scheduling, where our buses on our busy lines, including Route 9, are now subject to that we run them basically to provide a gap. And number 9 is in our list of heavy runs. And so what we're doing is we are injecting additional buses onto 5 routes right now, and that by injecting the additional buses, we provide more capacity to spread out, observe a better social distancing, physical separation, and our software is able to allow the driver then not to follow the normal printed schedule that would tell them and regulate them how to drive, but to follow an onboard mobile data terminal that gives them a simple instruction on where to stay so we keep the buses spaced. So on some of the lines that we normally run every 11 or 12 minutes, we're running them every 8 minutes now.
Guys, in the interest of fairness, if we get one question and then a follow-up, and then we'll move to the next.
Before you go,
also
you had a question that you didn't get to ask. Could we just,
Thank you. A follow-up on to that disciplinary question, what are some of those consequences in the future that could pop up?
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that.
For bus drivers in the future who might have similar instance to this driver, you said there might be consequences. What might some of those be?
Well, typically for us, suspensions could be an oral warning, a written warning, or suspension. And the objective that we have is to make sure that drivers come to work when they're fit for duty. And that's our overwhelming. Now, if it takes a disciplinary process to get that across, then we'll cross that bridge when it comes.
So just to follow up, if there were 50 drivers out, did that put more pressure on some of the other drivers, maybe the newer drivers? This driver, was he relatively new? He didn't have one established route. Did it put pressure on some of the other drivers to maybe pick up the slack?
Another thing that we have done is that we have changed our schedule to a Saturday schedule. And one of the things about a Saturday schedule is that they're scheduled to operate faster because the traffic on Saturday is not as bad as during the weekdays. And so as a result of that, we actually have a surplus of drivers right now every day are able to do that, even though even if the attendance goes up a little bit to that. We can do that. I'm gonna try to keep doing that until at least December. December is when we make another schedule change, and so we'll do it. In addition to that, we have been increasing our service almost daily, and we are scheduled again in August. We're going to be ramping up to about 100% of the service level that we had prior to this, but we're going to be doing it on a little bit faster schedule, and that makes it a little bit more efficient, and it's better for the customers because they get into their workplace faster, and we can take advantage of it while traffic is like it is right now.
Well, one other question: have you handled some of these incidents on the buses? Using police, I heard a friend of mine say that there was a young man who took off his mask while he was on, and then the bus driver stopped the bus and they actually called police.
Our protocol, first of all, we're doing our best to inform the public that they need to wear a face mask while riding the bus, not just while getting on the bus. We've made some new graphics that show a mask down here saying, a big X, red X, you can't do that. So you have to wear the full face mask. And our protocol for someone that does not comply is that we'll stop the bus, we'll call the police. Thankfully, that doesn't happen very often, and most of the time, I know I talk to my colleagues on the mainland, and there's a lot more incidences on the mainland of people refusing to wear masks than there is here, and that's a good thing.
Yeah, Jim Mendoza had a question.
Jim.
I'm sorry for insulting you earlier.
No, you didn't, not at all. Roger, the drivers do have those screens that are hanging up there, but oftentimes they're just tied back, and they're not being used to separate the driver from the passengers who are boarding. Is that going to be one of the mandatory things that shower curtain plastic screen needs to be in place?
We'll probably have to go through, Jim, a replacement of those because over time they become clouded, and it is necessary for the driver to be able to see clearly to the mirrors and the door. So I know I've had complaints from my operators that after 2 months of these things been on, they're getting clouded up, I can't see out of them, and so I've asked my staff to look at replacing them with just cleaner ones. In addition to that, we are demoing already, we're demoing some plexiglass barriers that on on one bus. There are three manufacturers that make those. We are going to try to take a look at each one of them. But my staff in DTS are committed, subject to figuring out funding and all of those things, to do it. Yeah, you know, it used to be in the days before this virus that we thought of barriers as something to prevent it, to protect an operator from assault and from those kind of things. And that's true. But they also, we thought of it as, I don't know how much aloha that really shows if the guy's in a cage and he's all done. I think those days are over for us, right? Everybody recognizes that we have to have safety for employees and for the public. And so everybody, I think the union included, is committed to trying to outfit the buses with plexiglass. That'll take time. And in the meantime, we're going to do the best we can with our plastic curtains.
How do you reassure the public that riding the bus is still safe after this incident?
That's what I'm trying to do now. I mean, we are doing a lot. You know, we are sanitizing the buses. We're spending several hundred thousand dollars every month, you know, sanitizing the buses. We are getting rules, the red line, do not cross the red line, the plastic curtain, the protocols. I really think the most effective thing that we have done is the rule that requires everyone to wear a mask while riding a bus.
I want to just add something there that,
you know, in the Honolulu Star Advertiser had a story either Sunday or today about this very issue and interviewed a couple riders who said it's the only way they get to work and home. It is the great social equalizer. You know, mass transit, our bus, and hopefully our rail in the future. And the pandemic, as you've seen it nationally, but even here, has struck those sometimes on the lower end of the economic spectrum. So not having the bus to ride to get to work and do other things would be devastating. And so our job, it's incumbent on us that we make the experience safe, that we do everything possible to protect our bus drivers and our handyman drivers and, of course, the riding public. And that's what we're talking about here today, to do exactly that and to get up to a higher standard than we have. And I think we'll get there. So people can ride the bus and feel safe and do the things that are so critical that our bus system provides to the people of Oahu. Thanks.
Mayor, this next question is from Rick Kwan, KITV. If more bus drivers test positive, might you consider rolling back reopenings?
That's a good question, and it's one that I've asked myself as I've watched what's happening up on the continent with the increase in the number of cases. In certain care areas, just dramatic increases, but we've also seen increases here on Oahu that are somewhat concerning. And so I think we'd be looking at things that we opened up last, the more risky things. You know, as we follow the Hopkins model, least risky first, exercising in parks, and now we have, you know, bars open, we have singing in karaoke bars and those kinds of things. So if need be, we'd start rolling back from those high-risk activities. And it's my hope we don't have to. And I believe we won't have to if everyone wears their face coverings, practice physical distancing, wash your hands, and do everything else that needs to be done. And particularly coming up for the 4th of July weekend, it's not a time to let our guard down, but to up our guard. And assuming wherever we go that someone you come into contact may have COVID-19 or we may have it. And if we assume that and do all the things I just described, we'll be able to control the spread of this virus and continue to open up to people from outside of the state of Hawaii starting on August 1st.
This next question is from Roger. This is actually from Manolo. Drivers say buses will get plexiglass barriers in September, but shouldn't that be done sooner?
Believe it or not, yes, it should be done sooner. Unfortunately, I'm competing like everybody did with PPE. I've got every bus company across the nation that are trying to buy barriers now. We may end up with a temporary sort of interim fix that would not be a long term, but it is just like the PPE was about 4 months ago, that there's a tremendous demand. Addition to that, in some of the places where these barriers are manufactured, they've had stay-at-home orders or quarantine-in-place orders, and the factories that make them have shut down. Most of those are coming back, but some of them were shut down. One of them in particular was shut down for 2 months, one of the main suppliers.
And a follow-up from Manolo. Many routes still have overcrowded buses. Drivers say Not enough riders know about the special duty buses added on. What can be done to let more riders know?
Okay, there's two. I think what he's talking about in special duty buses is, I told you what we're doing with our very busy buses, injecting more buses, using technology to spread them out. That works great. But how do you deal with Makaha, the bus that only runs every 30 minutes, or an express bus? And so what we're doing with those is we're monitoring every day. Our staff is out at Vineyard and at other key strategic places, actually counting the number of people that are on the bus each day. And we're responding by adding in extra buses. Now, the problem we have in doing that is that we would need to communicate that with the public, because they're waiting for a specific bus. And so what we're doing as a practice is that when we have a very busy bus, we're sending out one of those special duty buses at the same time as the busy bus, so that it either comes after the busy bus is full, or the drivers will do one stop, then the other stop, then the other stop to pick it in. Particularly, we've had issues on Route 40, we've had issues on Route C, we've had issues on Express Bus 81 from Waipahu, and those are the strategies we're using for those buses that the public needs to rely upon a schedule in order to catch the bus. The other ones I talked about come so frequently that you don't have to rely upon a schedule.
This next question is for the mayor, Nikki Schoenfeld, KHON2. A recent DOH survey found fewer residents view the virus as serious as they did back in April. They're becoming lax on basic health guidance. Your thoughts and concerns leading into the July 4th holiday weekend?
You know, Nikki, that's a good question, and one that I share, and why I've emphasized the tragic outcome. We just lost another person last Friday to the virus. If that was your father, mother, relative of some sort, you know, you'd be devastated. This virus has extremely deadly consequences, and so we got to assume that everyone has it. We need to wear our face coverings. We need to be practicing physical distancing. And here's the request coming up on this 4th of July weekend. You know, people think it's beautiful like today and everything is okay, but the virus is among us, travels among us, and we need to make sure when we get together with our friends, our families, our loved ones, our relatives, that we do it with all the guidelines. You know, if you're outside, a gathering of no more than 100. If you're inside, a gathering no more than 50. And really, you should be within your own family unit, in pods of family unit, being very, very careful. And I would request that those who are out at our beaches this coming weekend, where if at all possible, wear your face covering, even when it's hot. When you're eating your musubi or your teri chicken, no. But otherwise, just assume that someone you love could get sick from you, or you could get sick from them. If we do this, we'll get through this weekend, and we can continue to manage to open up and get to somewhere where there's a vaccine on the horizon, and then we can breathe a lot easier and start taking off our face coverings.
Nikki also asked, many people are eager to get back to work. Others think we're reopening too soon with the spikes in cases on the mainland. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, that's a, we hear that, even as a mayor, I hear that from our own city employees. Some are complaining that they're coming back to work. Others have been at work and want to get to work, and I hear the same in the private sector. And I think we all need to act responsibly. We see what's happening on the continent in places like Texas and California and Arizona and Florida. And I think there you are seeing irresponsible actions being taken by leaders, including our president, who somehow implied that wearing a face covering was a sign of weakness, that you weren't macho enough, and some people took it to heart in these states. Or their governors said the same. And now those very own governors are now telling their residents to pull back. Florida is closing beaches on 4th of July. We don't want to have to do that here. I believe that the people of Oahu and the people of the state of Hawaii have greater responsibility and greater kuleana to their ohana, to not jeopardize everyone like they've done in some of these other places. Is that it? Any others? So anyway, Michael, you have any hard questions?
Hey, can I say something?
Yeah, Hiro has something, but you gotta ask him a question. Okay, Hiro, come on up.
Thank you. So during this pandemic, which is when we need healthcare the most, a number of people have lost their jobs, and their health insurance is tied to their jobs. So the work that we're doing with the community health centers is to provide an opportunity for those to receive health care to include COVID-19 testing. And so I want to thank Mayor for having the wisdom to work with the community health centers. Really want to thank you for that. And if you are going to go to one of the community health centers to get tested, please call ahead. We will make sure the phone number for each health center is available to make sure that there's not a crowding issue at the health centers as you go to get tested. Thank you.
Wait, you have any last comments? No? Okay, we want to thank all of you, and we'll be seeing you again maybe tomorrow even. Okay, thanks, guys.